So. Welcome back to another monster vlog.
Here's my question. Would you consider that a monster movie?
Well, we haven't even told them what we saw yet.
Well, let's tell the good people.
1923's...
Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Yeah, and if you haven't been... If you're new to the series, we are currently traversing through Universal's monster movies.
And some horror movies.
And some horror movies. Well, basically the way we decide is, like, last time we did their version of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, the one that they released in 1913... we're doing this one because, according to the Wikipedia article, we're basically consulting, like, a variety of sources. Like, ones that we know are classified as monster movies. You know, basically
the classic Universal monsters.
The classic Universal monsters. And then we're also basing this off of the VHS series that they were running back in the 90s, which includes some non-monster horror movies. Mm-hmm. So we're going to hit a few of those up on the way. But today we did The Hunchback of Notre Dame starring Lon Chaney.
Which is about as long as Return of the King with no music or sound.
Yeah. Yeah, it's on Netflix Instant currently. I don't know when this video comes out if it'll still be there.
It should be. It's public domain.
Is it?
I think it is.
Possibly. I know Phantom of the Opera is public domain.
I'm under the assumption... Well, Phantom of the Opera came after Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Yeah.
I'm under the assumption that every movie before the advent of sound is public domain, so...
I think with the exception of a few... Because there are some that they still have, like, a really tight grasp on copyright. But whatever! Hunchback of Notre Dame!
Okay.
Wow!
And it was pretty just as epic as Return of the King, I would say.
I won't even say like this was. Okay, obviously between 1913 with Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde and this in 1923, the scale of everything had been ramped up so much. Like, they had honed the craft a little bit more. You saw a lot more different angles, a lot more uses of color gels to dignify night, day, or really intense, fiery scene. Like, there's the scene where Quasimodo's up at the top of the tower and dumping the molten lead down on this mob. That's all covered in red, but... what can we classify? Like, really, the only monstrous part of it is Lon Chaney's performance.
Which was... phenomenal.
Which was phenomenal. I mean, from a guy whose parents were deaf, that's really the best way that he can communicate was through physical communication.
Really?
And yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. We watched Monster Madness, dear.
I didn't remember that part.
Okay. Well, yeah, his parents were deaf, so that's... He became a master of non-vocal communication. That's why he was such an amazing...
And
silent
to be able
actor.
To not only convey so much emotion and intent through body language and facial expression, but to do that under so much makeup and prosthetics and friggin' cotton gauze in his cheeks to make alter the shape of his mouth. Just like...
Yeah.
That's acting on expert level.
And he was a master, and this movie proved it. This was actually the first time I had seen a full movie where he was the star.
Really?
Really. I had never seen Phantom of the Opera. I had never seen this. I had never seen any of his other movies. But this was a damn good introduction. But, okay. Throughout the whole thing... Well, actually, toward the end. We didn't do this right at the beginning, but toward the end... She was requesting that we put on...
The actual score from the Disney version.
The actual score from the Disney version.
Because it would work. There were parts that would really work.
And so...
I will say, it's not as happy as the Disney version, but it's still better than the original book.
Quasimodo dies.
Like, sad.
Like, sad death. Like, he was stabbed in the back by the guy he chucks over the ledge.
My face.
It is so beautifully tragic. He goes down to the bells to ring them for the last time and just freaking croaks. And that's the movie. Credits. Dead. I mean, by today's standards, this would not fly structurally.
There are scenes that just keep going on and going on. But the end was probably some of the most solid filmmaking before the advent of sound, like, ever, I would say.
Or, like, really the perfection of a three-act structure.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we saw, in the time frame of when we recorded these, we saw Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde yesterday, but obviously it's going to be, like, maybe a week or two after for them.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, it did drag in some parts.
Yes. I had to wake you up.
You had to wake me up, because Netflix version has no sound.
No sound at all.
It is literally silent.
Mm-hmm.
Which did help it a little bit. I mean, we kind of toyed around with some music. A couple parts.
Played the goblin battle music from Labyrinth during the siege of Paris.
But that's not... is this really the point of the vlog, though? Doug, ooh. What did Haley draw, though?
Oh, yes. What I drew this time. That I left over here.
What did Haley draw today with a pen and paper on...
I did a scene from an original story of mine that will probably stay in my head forever. But it's like the queen and her brother, the captain of the guard, and it's very flowy and chivalrous, and not the way the dudes acted in Hunchback of Notre Dame at all. But yeah, I felt like I'd draw something flowy.
It does flow.
And chivalrous.
Mm-hmm. But back to this. It definitely wasn't the Disney version.
No. No.
And you were...
Esmeralda was not, like, friggin' built Demi Moore.
Okay.
She looked 13.
That was
the... She freaking looked like prepubescent.
That is literally the whole, like, hinge pin.
That's the plot. Wants to get with Esmeralda.
Everybody wants to pork Esmeralda. Like, literally, Phoebus, who has...
A fiancé. Called Fleur de Lis.
Like the guy, the douchebag.
Jehan.
Like,
who is basically Frollo.
Then you have...
Gringor,
who is the poet, I think?
Who's the poet. But he's, like, more indebted to Esmeralda, because he's not, like, all jealous now. Like, oh, man.
At first he was.
Yeah.
At first he was, then he actually saw her. He actually saw the actual Esmeralda, not just a pair of boobs.
Yes.
Which, this is actually a very...
As like...
Like, I don't know if the video's gonna be out by, like, then, but you're gonna... I mean, she's currently... Right now, she's currently working on, like, a Disney... misogynist Disney characters.
In Disney. Like, intentionally misogynist characters.
How many of those tropes that you're, like, currently working on did you see in this?
Because, like, there's this running theme of dudes that would just see Esmeralda as, you know, this pretty pair of boobs and not see her as a person. And the people that do end up seeing her as a person, you know, actually progress as human beings as opposed to people that see her as a pretty pair of boobs. Like, even Clopin, he viewed her as a daughter. But he didn't really consider her choices in anything. He was just too freaking politically minded.
Right, I mean, he was all about, like...
With the aristocracy!
Overthrowing the aristocrats.
And he really didn't care if he had to trample over his daughter to get there.
Right.
Which was just not cool.
Like, in some cases, he almost did.
Pretty much.
And then there was, like, this weird subplot that went, like... That kinda had feet and legs of its own, but it didn't really go anywhere past the reveal.
That's actually more important than with the book.
It is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, can we, like, clue the audience into this?
At the beginning, there's this old woman in the basement of Notre Dame who just, like, insults everybody who goes past.
And when Esmeralda passes...
And especially Esmeralda, because...
She's a gypsy.
And we do apologize for that word. That's the word they use in the book and the movie, and you really can't get past it, though we know it's very derogatory.
Is it even now?
Yes.
Like, incredibly?
Incredibly.
We'll just call him G-Man. I know that's a completely different...
Because it's hard to say, because they said the actual word in the movie, and that's what they're referred to in the movie, but that is not what the actual people in the culture group like to be called, and they get really offended when you get called that. So it's...
Nomadic people.
Roma.
Roma, okay.
Roma is the term.
I didn't know that before this.
It's educational, yeah.
I know. We're going to get a lot of downvotes because...
I just don't want to make people unhappy. And
okay.
I want people to be happy.
But anyway, so she lays into Esmeralda really heavily, and then we cut to, like, this older couple, like, going, like, oh, what's her problem? She had a daughter who was taken from her. Guess who?
It ends up being
Esmeralda. And she finds out because she, as a little girl, she gave her this little amulet thing. And she rips it off of her and, like, looks at it and remembers. And she, like, pleads for her protection or safety because she's being hauled off for execution because she was accused of stabbing Phoebus when it was really Mr. McDouchebag.
That's his name, though.
Because I can't remember French names.
Nor pronounce them.
Choplin.
Clopin.
Clappin. He wasn't the jester type as he was in the Disney movie.
He wasn't as cool. He was just in Rojas.
The poet was better at being Clopin than Clopin.
Yep. I liked Clopin a lot less than... like them in the Disney version. he's one of those typical people that's all activism and no compassion. Which, you know, I don't... Those kinds of people are not fun.
Right. But he did...
But his death scene was really kind
of... Would you even consider that a death scene? Because you... Okay.
Because he died!
With all of the... I'm pretty sure this had to happen, like, somewhere down the line for, like, re-releases. Because we noticed that this was also a re-release, too. And a re-edit.
Really?
Yeah.
Re-edited.
That's what that whole thing at the beginning, like, there's a re-release of the so-and-so year that wasn't 1923. It was, like, 1950-something.
So it definitely would have had to change some spots.
So, literally, all of the death scenes, all of the stabbings, like, all of Quasimodo's lashing scenes, or his lashing scenes.
There were some very conspicuous cutaways.
I thought it was effective, but if it's altered...
I thought it was effective.
If it is altered, I want to know where the original is, and why they decided to cut it. Film preservation, guys. I know that wasn't really a big thing back then, but... I mean, look at what happened to London after midnight. Gone. Like, probably Lon Chaney's greatest work lost to history. We don't know. I'm hoping it's in some dude's collection. I'm really hoping, because I want to see...
Someday they'll find it.
I want to see a Blu-ray release of that. Like, Universal will buy the... Well, it was Metro-Golden-Mayer.
Was it?
Yeah. It was an MGM.
Okay.
So Disney will buy it. They had a contract with MGM. Mm-hmm. They still have the great movie ride. We're totally getting off topic again.
Yes,
Hunchback!
You are.
But there was also one thing that I noted, like, or did I even mention this, like, between 1913 and 1923 that they upped the... Yeah, it did.
Yeah. I think we got to see the Square of Warriors.
Court of Miracles. No, Square of Mir...
You don't even know either.
That place on Universal's
lot.
Like, we saw it. Okay, one thing that I was really taken aback... Okay, back to the scale. They used a lot of extras.
Yes, they did.
I'm pretty sure that Carl Lindley just opened the gates and was like, okay, who wants to be in a movie? And that was it.
Put on a bunch of weird crap and jump in.
Do you know how to ride a horse? Come on.
I bet you, like, they call for, like, all the local cowboys. They probably brought their own horses. That's what they did when the charge of the Rohirrim and Return of the King. All the Wranglers brought their own horses, and that's how they did the majority of the charge. So they definitely did that back then.
Nice.
Well, it really was not as tight as Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, just because it was such a huge story.
No.
And Victor Hugo wrote the original to be a huge story.
And that's also another thing. Back in the old days of film, when they had these competing movie studios, they're like, okay, you're going to see a one-reel Charlie Chaplin movie. Oh, well, what about this two-reel comedy with freaking Buster Keaton? All right, well, we're going to answer back with a three-reel. All right, well, what about an hour-long movie?
Mr. Griffith.
And so on and so forth until you get Intolerance. But I'm going to do this with every one of these movies. Put yourself in the mindset of an audience member in 1923.
Very.
Was this shocking?
Oh, yeah.
But even as, like, seeing Lon Chaney in full makeup and acting.
Any version of The Hunchback of Notre Dame is a heavy story with heavy themes, and it's got, like, racism and sexism and just everyday prejudice and just the normal horror of that kind of life.
So because of that, would you consider this horror film?
Not in the traditional sense.
I would say, if anything, it's more of a gothic horror movie. Like a really, I wouldn't even say lighthearted, but a lighter gothic.
I would consider it just a plain epic. Really.
An epic?
Yeah.
An epic with horror elements?
Mm-hmm. A dark epic.
I don't even know why
the original story was very much a dark epic.
Like, I know the monster makeup and Lon Chaney's Quasimodo is considered a monster. Would you consider this a monster movie?
I really don't think so.
Because he's not even in it that much.
He's not even that monstrous when he's in it. He's devout Catholic.
There's a scene where he's straight up praying. He is on
his
knees.
He does a sign of the cross and everything.
Yeah, doing a sign of contrition.
Like, and I love that because, you know, that part, the spiritual side of it, was very much intact. It was, the Disney version was definitely their most spiritual movie in the most blatant sense. And this part was still intact, possibly even more intact. And I think that, I also think that the young lady who played Esmeralda was very good in her role.
Absolutely.
There's not much a silent movie heroine can do, but she was very good in her role.
I already talked about how the whole main point is Pork and Esmeralda.
Mm-hmm, but like, she had her own, like...
She had her own personality,
which
is rare to see back then.
Because, like, usually it's swoon and faint and...
Like, she stood on her own.
But she had, like, her own authority. She walked with confidence, despite being the shortest person in that cast.
Because Lon Chaney
looking like a teenager.
A teenager?
A teenager, excuse me.
A teenager?
Shush.
Racist. I should talk. But anyway. Wow. I'm still kind of processing this.
I wouldn't consider it universal horror, but I would consider it very effective as a film.
I would say, like, in the heyday of, like, okay, if you consider holding this up to Intolerance, if you say that that's...
I haven't seen Intolerance, so I can't hold that
I thing. Know! But, okay, if you, like, Intolerance is like the Cloud Atlas to... Hunchback of Notre Dame's... There's really no other way I can put it. Return of the King. Like, which would you rather see? And it really, like... But would you recommend this, though? Are you glad that we did see this?
I'm glad we saw it. I would recommend this to people that are interested in watching it for the long haul. This is something that you need to give your full attention to.
And put it is dead silent. Like,
put some classical music on. Put some, like, some Vaughn or Philip Glass or some kind of meditative classical music. Because honestly a chore to watch it completely silent, and it's 2 hours at least.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are willing to watch it actively, not just, you know, put it on for background, just watch it actively, then I would definitely recommend it. It's worth your time.
Yeah.
And tell us what you think.
Yeah.
We want to hear from you.
If you like Haunted Mansion, like, comment, and subscribe. I'm meant to come out as Hunchback. If you like Hunchback, people, just in general.
Daddy, quit being accidentally stupid.
I'm sorry. Just like this if you cry over time.
Compare it to the Disney version, compare it to the version with What's His Face. There really is no comparison. The version that with the person's name who I can't remember.
It'll pop up somewhere on the screen. Oh, that was another thing. Like, you can totally tell. Sorry. Like, last time we were comparing, like, okay, the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Mr. Hyde totally looks like Jerry Lewis from Nutty Professor. I think there's subtle influence in the Goonies.
To Sloth.
Maybe.
Which, when you see the Goonies, because he hasn't seen the Goonies
would
yet.
You...
You'll
next time we're going to do Phantom of the Opera.
Yeah!
I won't
have any music either.
I'm going to pop it in, and it's going to have Gerard Butler.
No, it's not. That one's not a horror movie. That's a musical.
Okay, I'll put in 300. That has Gerard Butler.
Please don't put in 300.
Why not?
Because I see so much torso on a daily basis. 300 Phantom.
And here I said I was just waiting for you to come back home from work. When you do work.
Keep on digging, son. Keep on digging.
Next time is Phantom of the Opera. Thank you for watching.
Like, comment, subscribe.
Tell us
your thoughts.
Tell me I'm a freaking racist idiot.
You just told yourself that.
I apologize to all peoples of all nations for everything. I'm sorry I'm stupid and white and American.
Good. No, you're good. All right. Good night, folks. Happy hauntings.
Happy hauntings?
Yes.
Is that what you want to go out on?
I don't know.
Happy hauntings, my dear.